It is.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Gracious God, you made us in your image, and in that image, you gave us the power to create. When we create, we enter into your creative powers, and we help the world to see you in new and exciting and unique ways. In the words of Vincent van Gogh, it is good to love as many things as one can, for therein lies true strength. And those who love much do much and accomplish much. And whatever is done with love is done well. Amen. So that quote that I read at the end is from one of Vincent van Gogh's 800-plus letters to his brother Theo. There are people in this world who see the universe around them in very unique ways. And I have found that what Mozart did for music, what Einstein did for science, Van Gogh has done, at least for me, through art. And these are people who are so much of another world that sometimes our earthly society does not know what to do with them. They don't know how to relate to them. They don't know how to make sense of them. And oftentimes these people feel caught between this world and God's heavenly kingdom. They look around and they say, oh, why can't you see it? By the way, there are 3, 4, 5 chairs up front, and you get a bonus Van Gogh book if you come to one of the front tables. I think it would be best if we're up at tables. So if you can find a seat, grab a table. Oh, there are 2 more right here, 1 here, 3 there, 1 over there. And then if we run out of seats, we can grab a few more. I don't think we need a table if we run out of. Very good. So just as Iona and Canterbury and all of those sacred spaces end up being thin places between this world and the next, I would like today to talk about Vincent van Gogh as one of those thin people. People who give us that glimpse between this world and the next. So in order to get an idea of Van Gogh, we have his paintings, but his paintings give us his artistic expression. His brother Theo was about 4 years younger than he was, and he took on Van Gogh's living expenses as he gave up a real living and became an artist. And so a lot of his correspondence from brother to brother was saying, thank you, I received the check. Thank you very much. And when is the next one coming? Because I've got these 3 people I owe money to. What's wonderful about that is that then we get glimpses into Van Gogh's, what's going on in his heart, what's going on in his head. It's a crazy place to be. There are over 800 to his brother, but then there are also at least 100 more that have been preserved that he wrote to artist friends and other family members. The hard part, though, is that we do not have any of the letters that Theo wrote back to Vincent. So we hear one side of the conversation. It's like being on one end of the telephone, and you're saying, what are they saying? What are they saying? What are they saying? And all you can hear is the person on your side. So while it does give us an idea of who Vincent was and what his relationship with his brother was, it does give us a one-sided idea. So there are a lot of leaps that we have to make. On one of these tables is a book, Lust for Life, and I think it's down at that one. This is when Irving Stone took those letters and really tried to flesh it out and make the narrative of the story of what was his life. There are some leaps made in that book. But it's a really great way to dive into the life in a way that's going to just capture your imagination and pull you in. The letters, on the other hand, I'm at about 600 of 800. I mean, they just keep going and going and going. And you can see how Vincent really narrows in on one thought and hammers it to death. So they're not going to be there for the hardcore Vincent fan. And I highly recommend those. They are in this book, easy little paperback, Letters of Vincent Van Gogh. And this actually does not have all of them in it, but it kind of takes out the most important ones. So if you are hardcore, I suggest this one. If you are looking for just kind of a fun overview, then Lust for Life is the way to go. Now, this is not going to be an art history class. This is going to be Van Gogh and God. But we do need to kind of figure out the context, give ourselves a rooting in his life. So in 1853, Vincent is born, and I'm not going to even try to pronounce that, but it's in Holland. And he comes from a long line of Dutch Reformed pastors. His father was a Dutch Reformed pastor, his grandfather, his uncle. It was assumed that one of the boys, because at that point only boys could become the pastors, that one of their boys would follow in this line of pastors in the Dutch Reformed Church. And a couple of years later, about 4 years later, Theo is born. And they both go immediately after their schooling, which schooling at that point was a few years. And that was considered higher education if you got through 4, 5, 6 years of school, and he was off at boarding school. But after their schooling, they kind of fell into their uncle's, one of their uncle's paths, which was to become art dealers. Now think about it, in that day and age, there were not smartphones, there were not computers, there was not a whole lot of mass production of things. So art dealers really were front and center to communication of ideas and thoughts and expressions between cultures. So art dealer at that point meant you were a networker of culture, of thought, of communities. And so their uncle sent, Uncle Vincent, for whom Vincent was named, set Vincent up at Goupel and C, and I hope I'm saying that right, but he worked for this art dealer for quite a long time. And at this point, all of his letters are talking about the art that he has found and wants to share with the world, and it's fascinating. Vincent, really, from the very beginning of his exposure to art, is looking for, how does this help me see the world? And every description of a new etching or a new charcoal or a new painting that he's found, he's saying, oh, now this piece of my life makes sense because I found this art and I'm trying to figure out who needs this piece. And so that's really fascinating to go through all of that. He becomes more and more interested in his theological studies. He's kind of picking up the Bible and doing a lot of reading of scripture and different theologians, and becomes much more interested in that and less interested in the art dealing and more concerned about taking people's money, about wheeling and dealing, about different things like that. So he starts to back off from the art dealing and tells his delighted father that he wants to go into theological studies. Throughout the letters, there are little sketches that he'll send to his brother. So this is one of those. This is a church that he served in. He went to Ramsgate, England, and he was a curate and teacher for the Reverend T. Slade Jones, and this was a Methodist minister. He had lots of little parish churches all around, and so it's fun to see in the margins. He kind of sketches out those churches to show his brother where he is. Again, at this day and age, you don't have the photos you can send. You don't get to post it up on Facebook. You have to sketch a picture of your church and send it with a letter along to let them know where you are. But it was at this place as he's learning how to preach and learning how to be a pastor, that he comes across John Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress, and he really begins to look at all of his spiritual journey as a pilgrimage. He also finds a lot of paintings by George Henry Boughton. And this one in particular catches his eye. This one is called Godspeed, Pilgrim Setting Out for Canterbury. And as he talks about this painting in probably seven of the letters to his brother, in fact, this was such a pivotal painting for him that it hangs in the Van Gogh Museum today. But he thinks about this poem that he's come across by Christina Rossetti called Uphill. Does the road wind uphill all the way? Yes, to the very end. Will the day's journey take the whole day long? From morn to night, my friend. Van Gogh is very much in search of where his pilgrimage is going to lead him. And Pilgrim's Progress and this painting and this poem become center to his spiritual journey. So as he's thinking about all of these things and about pilgrimage, he preaches his first sermon. His first sermon on October 29th. This year that was Reformation Sunday. So on October 29th, 1876, he preaches his first sermon. Now be really glad that Sandy and Benjamin and Randy and I do not use the Van Gogh style of preaching, because this was like a 8-page single space sermon that he preached. And he made the point, he reiterated the point, he told you the point again, and then he finally wrapped it all up. But in doing so, and I'll give him some grace, it was his first time to preach, but in doing so, he really talks about the woman in the painting of this pilgrimage to Canterbury. And he relates it to one of Paul's letters, and he says that the woman's name is sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. And the imagery is very much our Easter burial liturgy imagery throughout the entire thing. Sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. And I'm going to read a little excerpt of this sermon to you all, but not the whole thing. Our nature is sorrowful, but for those who have learnt and are learning to look at Jesus Christ, there is always reason to rejoice. It is a good word, that of St. Paul's, as being sorrowful yet always rejoicing. For those who believe in Jesus Christ, there is no death and no sorrow that is not mixed with hope, no despair. There is only a constantly being born again, a constantly going from darkness into light. They do not mourn as those who have no hope. Christian faith makes life to evergreen life. Now imagine Vincent van Gogh standing up in the pulpit of a little countryside church in Ramsgate, England, and preaching those words. Sent chills down me the first time I read it. And I want to give you all a second to just talk at your tables, or if you're in chairs at the back, kind of huddle up a little bit, and talk about what that might mean to you in our context today as Episcopalians, as Christians. What does it mean to be sorrowful yet always rejoicing on our pilgrimage through this life and to God's heavenly kingdom? Did you have a question, Margaret? The last line, Christian faith makes life to evergreen life. Evergreen. And you'll see that in some of his paintings later on as well. The evergreen becomes about as significant as the wheat field. So take a moment and think about what it means in our burial liturgies, in our Easter liturgies, in the way that we live out our faith, what it means to be sorrowful yet always rejoicing. And the Christian life is evergreen life. Go for it. Okay, I always hate to break off great conversation, but I'm curious to hear a few of the things that might have bubbled up at the different tables. I'll do my best to kind of jot them down. What are some things that this made you think of? The onset of Van Gogh's depression, which we'll be getting to soon, yeah. So being respectful and that we are in tune with other people's sorrow, even as we rejoice in the Spirit. Yeah, that's great. What else? Fallen people. Todd. To for those of you who can't hear, they're talking about the sorrowful yet rejoicing, that we are fallen people, but that rejoicing piece is in forgiveness and in Marjorie.
I was thinking about the painting, you know, and you're kind of starting off at the bottom of the hill looking up, and you're having to, you know, that, oh gosh, I've got this big hill, you know, to go to climb up, and that's sorrowful. But then along the way, you meet people and events happen that encourage you that you can rejoice on as you're following your path up the hill.
From a Christian perspective, sorrowful is today and rejoicing is forever.
Wow. Drop that mic. Yeah, sorrowful today, rejoicing is forever. And I think that gets into that evergreen that we are talking about at this table, that evergreen being forever. What else?
Our group talked about we live in a sorrowful world. I mean, you can't pick up the newspaper or turn the television on without seeing some sorrow in many different aspects. And so our question was, how do we rejoice? And we decided to come to church. And in a loving parish community, to be surrounded by people who are capable of rejoicing and are happy and joyful about various aspects in their lives. So to be around loving, friendly people.
Very good. So we've got fallen and forgiven. We have today and forever, today and eternal. We have, you know, kind of the world sorrows, and then the love of community. All of these things. And, you know, it's amazing because all of these things do show up in Van Gogh's letters around this time. One of the things that we talked about at our table is that Van Gogh, even at this point, had no formal art training, but he had a painter's eye. At this point, he's looking at other paintings around him and trying to make sense of the world. But even as he's observing other people's art, I think he's training his own art eye and giving it voice. If you read his sermons, it's a lot of amazing imagery and amazing scene painting. If you're looking for flow and where we're going next, you're probably not going to find it in his sermons, but you're going to find a lot of amazing glimpses into heaven. So they did not renew his contract. they did not think he was meant to be a preacher in that area. And so he decides he's going to do the next step, which is go into theological studies. Now, theological studies in our day and age, we went for 2 or 3 years of intense studies. For him, it was going to be eight years of intense studying of language, of history, of culture, of deep scriptural study, and he dives into it full force for the first 6 months. And he loves it for the first 6 months. And he burns out very quickly and decides that he cannot do another 7 years of theological study, which, of course, to his father is devastating. His father all but disowns him at this point, says he has no follow-through, he has no stick-to-itiveness, he has no ambition in life, and he needed to buckle down and figure out what he was going to do. There are also signs at this point of the ongoing and beginning to see signs of the mental strain that he's under and the emotional strains that he's under with depression or, I mean, there are lots of people who look back on his life and diagnose what he had, but there's a lot of that as well. Part of his creative genius comes out of that, and it's his gift and his burden. So he moves on from theological study and then goes, you know, because when they don't want you in one region, you just move to the next, right? So he goes to Preparatory Evangelist Seminary in Belgium to train as a preacher in that context. So this is southern Belgium in the Borinage, and he goes to be a missionary to coal miners in that area. Now, I had a bit of a geeking out moment when I put together the timeline and realized that just as Van Gogh was leaving theological studies to go be a missionary among the coal miners is when Constance and her companions were gathering up all their things to come back into Memphis to be among our people in the midst of the worst yellow fever epidemic. So on one side of the globe, you have Van Gogh going out into the fields of the coal miners. On our side of the globe, you have Constance and her companions ministering to our darkest hours. So it's always fun when your last two classes connect up like that. So this is a piece of one of Van Gogh's letters to his brothers as he's getting ready to leave one and go to the next. And the beginning of each of our great Thanksgivings, when we say, "The Lord be with you," lift up your hearts. This is called the Sursum Corda. Lift up your hearts. And this is a piece of Van Gogh's context as well. He knows this piece of our liturgy. And he writes to his brother, "So let us go forward quietly, each on his own path, forever making the light, sursum corda, lift up your hearts. And in the knowledge that we are as others are, and that others are as we are, and that it is right to love one another in the best possible way, believing all things, hoping for all things, and enduring all things, and never failing." Even as he is hitting a transition in his own life, he is preaching in his letters. He does a lot of sketching and drawing at this point, still has no formal training in any of this, but he's been an art dealer, so it's not foreign territory to him, but he does a lot of these kind of coal drawings, and he sends a lot of them home to his brother. And it's about this time that his brother starts to take on his living expenses. So the volume of letters increases, and the thank you for the money, and when will the next group come through, and they don't extend his contract. Again, he is found to be too zealous. He is found to be their John the Baptist, and they are tired of hearing that they are not ministering to the coal miners well enough, and that they could be doing more. And they say, "Get this thorn out of our side. Vincent, it is time for you to go home." So again, prophets are not always loved by their communities. He goes through a whole series of changes at this point. He's kind of wrestling with, what do I do next? I've tried this preaching thing. At this point, he has a lot of anger, not at God, but at the church, at the institution of the church that has now rejected him twice. And he is, he starts referring to his father as that Jesuit and calling all of his phrases Jesuitisms and talking about how the church has warped the people who have begun leading it. So this is when the priest starts perking up her ears and saying, when have I been guilty of doing just that and getting caught up in the institution and in the organization and forgetting about those coal miners in the depths of our earth. And so he does a long path. It's really fun because there are whole Van Gogh tours that you can take. And so this is just one map that kind of journeys through his time. He starts to look into formal training now. He says, well, I can't hack it as a preacher. I'm going to preach my word in the way that I know best. I'm going to start painting it, and I'm going to start drawing it. And so he goes to the academy in Brussels. He goes back to his home and starts to then apprentice with another uncle, Mauve, who's kind of a gloomy fellow. And a lot of people said, oh, he's rubbing off on you, Vincent. Not good. He takes in a prostitute and her child. He is always looking for the marginalized and reaching out to them. He has unrequited love to a cousin, Key Voss, and they're probably, I don't know, 120 letters about her. And then he finds this lady thrown out into the streets with her daughter and takes her in, and that really does rile up the wrath of his family. They're all saying, what are you doing? You are bringing disreputation to the entire family. You've got to stop this. He continues to paint the sacred in the everyday. As he's doing all of his studies, he's not doing them of royalty, of high society, of fancy things. He's doing them of potato eaters. He's doing them of people in the field working. He's doing an entire series on the weaver and people doing everyday tasks because he sees such beauty in these people. And he sees them as not being given the respect and dignity that we promise to give every human. He falls in with Impressionists, and this becomes a much brighter time of his life, both in his personal life and in his palette, in his painting. He moves more from drawing into the painting, and instead of these gloomy kind of everyday ones, he starts to use a much brighter paint. His paint thickens, it gets more movement in it, more life in it, and he begins to feel more life in himself. He meets Gauguin, and they have a very tumultuous working relationship. He wants him to move into his yellow house, and he gets it all ready in Arles, which is on our map. It's all the way down at the bottom. So they're getting close to the coast, close to beautiful country. I mean, just gorgeous area. Gauguin does come to live with him, but we all know how that ended, with a lost ear and a nervous breakdown when they don't see eye to eye on the way things should be done. He has a series of what they call epileptic attacks. A lot of people say, no, these were more panic, anxiety, depression. He's kind of in and out of treatment during this time, in and out of bouncing back home and then into asylums even. But each time he comes through, and when he's on the other side of it, he says, he goes back to that same refrain, sorrowful yet always rejoicing. I know the deepest sorrows, and yet I always know I'm going to find it through to the other side. And here I am again. So you have a whole series of that. His brother Teo is still paying all of his bills and financing him. And there's still that question of, you know, next month I'm going to get these where I can sell them. There are a lot of people who say he only sold one painting in his whole life. For a while that was believed to be true. There are actually records of people commissioning him to do series throughout this time. So whether he actually got paid on them or not, I don't know, but they at least know that he was commissioned to do other art. But most of it he'll send either home to his brother or he'll put in, because he has art dealers in the family, he puts them into places, but he thinks he's being paid for his painting. His brother thinks he's graciously accepting his paintings and paying for Vincent's expense. But they do have this deep, abiding love for each other. And Teo is the person that Vincent feels he can open his heart to and say, this is what I'm seeing now in my life. The fields become very central to Vincent's journey again. Most of his fields have a sower in them, and then sometimes they have a reaper in them. And he talks about the reaper being that symbol of death and the sower being the symbol of new life again. And he looks at those wheat fields and he says, that's it. That's what we are all about. The field, the harvest, the going from death into life and then back into death and then back into life. And you see it when you look out into this field. Now, also, if he's in an asylum at the time, he has views out of his windows into these fields. And always he's looking out saying, I might be in the field that is being laid to rest right now. And next season, that sower is going to come back. And I'm going to have new life. So the reaper and the sower in the wheat fields are just keep popping up over and over and over again in his letters. Some of you might remember that I preached on the sower a little while back. And what's beautiful is that Lynn, raise your hand, Lynn. Yeah, there you go. Gave me a wonderful gift of letting me borrow two of her books as I got ready for this class, because this one, The Color of Light, are poems based on Van Gogh's late paintings. And this is just a beautiful poem that I want to read to you about the sower. These are all written by Marilyn Chandler McIntyre, and I'll have this up here, but then they're going to go back to live with Lynn after this, because I've been hanging on to them for a couple of months now. The Sower, this was 1888. You have to get there just as the grass turns blue. Just when two birds come to glean and the sun has begun its vesper song over the hum of the wheat field. You have to keep your distance. The sower is at prayer. The swing of his arm and the long stride turn old parables to chant. Some seed fell underfoot. Some seed fell on the rock. Some seed fell among thorns. Some seed fell on good soil. These are the kingdom's secrets. He who has ears, listen. Taking no more thought as he sings than the birds who hover among the furrows, casting their shadows on the burning air. Paintings have a way of helping us to see things in new ways, of breaking scripture open for us, of breaking maybe something that we're going through in our lives open for us. And Lynn also shared some words from Nathan Atwood, who is a Lenten preacher at her church back in 2013. He says, Van Gogh's gift was sharing his vision through his painting, not the painting itself, showing us his palpable vision so sunflowers and stars never look the same to us anymore. When I was in seminary, I was asked to preach on Nicodemus. And Nicodemus, to me, was a very intriguing fellow. And I found a poem when I was looking through, and it was between the poem and one of Van Gogh's paintings that I explored that story in our Bible. This is Wheat Field with Cypresses. And if you look at the sky, you see all the movement in there. I think that's what first struck me about Van Gogh's paintings, is they are not just a snapshot. You see that movement. And if you see one in person, it's thick. It's so thick that, where's Daniel? You have a story about that.
The New York Times said they found after 128 years in one of his paintings, the olive trees, a grasshopper embedded in the paint.
Such thick paint that you can have a grasshopper in there for over 100 years and nobody's known until now. I love that story. I love that story. But here is the wheat field with cypresses. Again, this kind of evergreen pops up again. Listen to the wind, Nicodemus. Listen to the wind. You can hear its sound. The night is full of it. Listen to it in the tops of the trees, but where it has come from and where it goes, no man knows. Now, Nicodemus, the Spirit of God is just like that, invisible yet unmistakable, intangible yet full of power, able to do wonderful things for you if only you stand in its path and turn your face to it and open your life to its influence. Just listen to the wind, Nicodemus. Listen to the wind. And if you want to go back to the original scripture, it's based on John 3, 1 to 21. That was written by James S. Stewart. And the name of that book is The Wind of the Spirit. So when I see Van Gogh's paintings, I see that movement. I see him seeing the Holy Spirit and all that he's doing. We all know that starry night. We all know the sunflowers and all these things. They're just so full of movement. They're not static to him. They're alive. And that's what it captures for me. This is in the town that Van Gogh spends his last year. Again, down on the coast, a beautiful place. He's made a little bit of peace with the church at this point. He has a pastor who is also a doctor. Back in the Dutch Reformed Church, who travels down here with him to be his pastor and his physician and to help him get through because the attacks are becoming more and more often, the panic, the anxiety, the depression. And so he is no longer feeling like it is safe to live by himself and have his own studio, so he now has a companion who's going with him and trying to take care of him. And it's at this time that you, again, hear so much about the reaper and the sower and the sorrowful yet rejoicing and the evergreens, and all of that imagery is still rolling through all of his letters. Pilgrimage shows up all over and over again. Where am I going? What am I doing? What is God calling me to do? How can I be my full self? In my moments, he says, his moments of lucidity, how can I use this gift that God has given me to the fullest? His art is actually taking off at this point. He's being included in some very important exhibits. He's made friends with the Impressionists and the Neo-Impressionists, and he's got this community of artists who are rallying around him and saying, you know what, you've got something that's unique and amazing, and they're really lifting him up. But at the same time, his emotional and mental state is deteriorating. And so there's that sorrowful yet always rejoicing in his life. I have a little clip that I want to show you all. This is on the song will probably sound familiar. It's a Don McLean song that he wrote about Vincent Van Gogh. But because I wanted to kind of highlight some of the paintings and just let you soak them in, I thought this was a great way to just give you a moment to sit with Van Gogh.
Starry, starry night, paint your palette blue and gray. Look out on a summer's day with eyes that know the darkness in my soul. Shadows on the hills, sketch the trees and the daffodils. Catch the breeze and the winter chills in colors on the snowy linen land. Now I understand what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen. Did not know how. Perhaps they'll listen now. Starry, starry night, flaming flowers that brightly blaze, swirling clouds in violet haze reflect in Vincent's eyes of china blue, colors changing hue. Morning fields of amber grain, weathered faces lined in pain, are soothed beneath the artist's loving hand. Now I understand what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they did not know how. Perhaps they'll listen now, for they could not love you. But still your love was true. And when no hope was left in sight on that starry, starry night, you took your life as lovers often do. But I could have told you, Vincent, this world was never meant for one as beautiful as you. Starry, starry night. Portraits hung in empty halls, frameless heads on nameless walls, with eyes that watch the world and can't forget, like the strangers that you've met. The ragged men in ragged clothes, a silver thorn, a bloody rose, lie crushed and broken on the virgin snow. Now I think I know what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they're not listening still. Perhaps they never.
So that's my friend Vincent.
What's that?
Oh, I did not produce that. I did not produce that. But it's one of those I look at every once in a while when I just, so for me, he's one of those thin people that you, through seeing his paintings and reading his letters, I catch a glimpse of God over and over again. And so often with those thin people, they're so misunderstood when they're doing their thing. And so who are those marginalized? Who are those people we don't quite know how to make sense of in our context? And how can they show us glimpses of the next world as well as this? There are books at the front few tables, and then the ones that I used up here, but there's one I want to bring to your attention. Some of you may know that before I went to seminary, I taught music, art, and drama, an integrated fine arts curriculum with children at St. George's. And it was wonderful because I was given no curriculum at all. I got to come up with it as I went along. And so my main goal, my main rubric was to send people out with a passion for the arts. And children are easy to do that with. They're wonderful and open. But this was a book, and to me, it's a book very much about our baptismal covenant and the promise that we make to respect the dignity of every human being. It's about the postman, and you saw the postman in the slideshow, but the postman and his son that Van Gogh boarded with when he was painting. And just as all the townspeople are saying, there goes that crazy painter, they're seeing him as a child of God. So if you want to get children interested in Van Gogh, this is a wonderful, wonderful book. It's called Camille and the Sunflowers. And I highly recommend this, and you can have a wonderful talk about what that means to respect the dignity of every human being. So thank you, and I'll be around if anybody wants to ask questions or talk further, and thanks again.